I decided to talk about this subject because, of course, in the Buddha Dharma, the whole idea of the mind and the heart is the center of the whole mandala of the Buddha Dharma. It starts with mind, it ends with mind, the mind transformed. So that's what we're going to talk about this morning. First of all, we cannot know anything at all, either outside or inside, except through the mind. Think about it. Everything outside of ourselves, the sky, the trees, the temple, the people, everything, we only know by what is directed to us through our sense organs. That means the eyes, ears, nose, tongue, and the physical body, the skin. And then how that is interpreted as they hit these impulses hit to the sense organs. The sense organs then interpreted that into the mind, which processes it. We have consciousnesses which cover the eyes, the ears, the nose, the tongue, and the skin. Except for that, we cannot know anything. Think of that. If we had different kinds of sense organs, we would perceive our so-called reality in a totally different way. If you were a fish, or if you were a fly, or even if you're a horse, you have sense organs, but they are slightly different sense organs, and they will interpret for you a reality which is just as real, but is very different from the reality which we perceive. And yet, what is real, what is unreal? If you were a nuclear physicist or whatever, or a subatomic biologist, you would perceive this table in a very, very different way. To us, it appears so solid, but to a physicist, of course, it's mostly space. But we don't perceive it that way, because our senses don't perceive it that way. Everything which we can possibly know is brought into us through our sense organs, then caught by the sense consciousnesses, and then interpreted by the mind. This we have to understand before we go any further. We cannot know anything except through the mind. When we are unconscious, then there is nothing. We are like a corpse, right? So the mind is of central importance. We cannot know anything. We cannot experience anything. Everything which we know, everything which we experience is the mind. And yet, when you say to people, "What is mind?" they don't know, because they never look. You know, we spend such a lot of time and money and thought and effort on our bodies, on keeping our bodies healthy, on keeping our bodies clean and nicely dressed according to our own ideas of what nicely dressed means. We spend a lot of time on our physical environment, on our houses, our rooms, our gardens, making them as aesthetically pleasing to ourselves as we possibly can. When we have our house, every day we sweep it, we clean it, we redecorate it, we try to furnish it according to how we think it should be. And then we live in it and we say, "This is my home, this is my house, it reflects me." But your house, your home, your room, it's just an external thing. The place that we really live is in here. Because apart from our minds, we cannot even experience our house and our homes. This is our real home. This is where we always live. Whether we're in India or Australia, America, Singapore, Taiwan, wherever we go, we take our minds with us. Right? We are never separated from our mind. Our mind is our true home. And yet that mind, which we have to carry with us everywhere, we can't get away from it. Do we exercise it? Do we clean it and wash it? Do we throw out the junk? Or are we accumulating more junk? You know, in your home, when things get kind of dirty and rotten and smelling or junky, we throw them out. We clean it, we brush it, we open the windows, we let fresh air in. But our home of the mind, it's really a junk pile. We have all this stuff which we've accumulated since we were little kids, and it's all in there. And then we get more and more and more. The things we read, the television we watch, the movies, the conversations, the thoughts we think. Junk pile. And never aired out. Just stuffed in more and more and more. And then on top of that, on top of this huge garbage pile, which we have accumulated, then we come to the Dharma. And so then we spread over a little cloth of, you know, now we're being ever so ethical, and we put up nice little pendants, pretty, you know, of the paramitas and all our studies, and we decorate it very lovely. But it's a garbage heap in there. It's a junk room. Do you understand? So then you're wondering why, despite the fact you've tried to make it look so pretty, it still smells so awful. So, the first thing we have to do is think about this. Whatever we do, wherever we go, whatever practices we undertake, we can only do it and experience it through the mind. So it behoves us, if we want to be happy people, if we want to be peaceful people, if we want to be people who really understand things clearly and therefore are genuinely able to benefit others and to benefit ourselves, then we need to get this house of the mind in some kind of order. As in an ordinary house. If you go to an ordinary house and it's full of junk, the first thing you do is to start at least throwing away some of the junk and opening up the windows, right? I mean, it makes sense. It's not enough to start, you know, adding more. You see, it seems to me that, excuse me, Ginla. The Tibetans, especially the Tibetans who were in Tibet, came to the Dharma with a fairly empty mind. They lived in a very empty country with vast empty landscapes. No trees often, just vast, vast. I mean, the thing which strikes people when they go to Tibet is these vast landscapes, right? Empty. Infinite. And so therefore, in those infant, because they lived in that very open, empty landscape, when they came to decorating, when they came to doing their painting, their tankas, they filled the space. Right? You look at a tanka, there's no space there. Right? You have the figure, and then you have this elaborate aura, and then you have all the other deities, and then you have flowers and trees and mountains, everything. It's full. The canvas is completely full. Because outside it was so empty. And likewise, in traditional Tibet, there was no radio, no television, no magazines, no novels. The only plays were plays about the Dharma. It was pretty empty, the mind. Their psyche was pretty spacious, lots of room in there. And so they filled it. But they filled it with things which were beneficial and helpful. They filled it with extremely complex philosophical reasoning. They trained a mind which was untrained. They filled the mind with extremely complex visualizations, just like their tankas. Full. Doesn't leave your space for one moment. Lights coming in, lights going out, thousands of deities in all directions. Everything seen so precisely. Nothing left to chance. They filled up the empty spaces of their mind with this extraordinarily complex and beneficial panorama. And so for them, it was wonderful and deeply transformative. But normally, we come to the Dharma with minds which are totally cluttered, absolutely full already, and mostly full of things which are not beneficial, not very useful. Some things useful, but some things not so helpful. It's all in there. All the programs we've ever watched on television, all the movies we've ever seen, all the magazines and books we've ever read, it's all there, inside. So we are full to the brink. We are like a glass which is already filled up with dirty water. It's no good trying to pour in elixir, ambrosia, into a vessel which is already filled up with dirty water. First you have to pour the water out. Do you understand? I mean, on the whole, the Tibetans in traditional Tibet were fairly empty vessels. So they were able to receive the elixir. But we come from a very different situation, and I think we should be aware of that. Because otherwise, all this tremendously rich and profound and subtle training is on a basis which is rotten. So it's like trying to put these beautiful frescoed walls and golden roofs on top of, a garbage heap. You wouldn't do that. First you have to, raise the whole building and then clean it up and then put down very, very firm foundations. And when you have the very firm foundations, then you can start building up the walls and thinking about the frescoes on the golden roof. There are a number of ways of going about this. There are a number of ways. I would do it with just a few. There is the traditional way, which is an excellent way, which is the way of penitence, in a way. The way of realizing that we do have a junk heap and that we're very sorry about this. And so we go the way of purification. In the Tibetan practice, there are many purificatory practices, such as the fasting ritual of the thousand-armed Avalokiteshvara or Chedrezig, the prostrations to the 35 confession Buddhas, and so on. There are a number of purificatory practices. Akshobhya Buddha is another purificatory practice. And if we have the right attitude, they really do work. They work at a very, very subtle level. But as with everything, you have to do it, you know. I mean, you have to do it enough that it gains some momentum. But personally, and this is just my personal opinion, although it is shared by some other lamas, I think what we really need to do is, because the mind, in one way, the mind is everything. We, as I say, cannot experience anything except through the mind. What is really important is to know the mind itself. We are always looking out, right? And we are always investigating what is going on outside. We investigate, you know, even into outer space. But we spend really very little time actually looking inside. I mean, even psychologists are still caught up here, you know, with their theories and their ideas, but it's very intellectual. They really don't just sit and look and ask themselves, well, what is a thought? We say, I think this, I think that. We have all our theories, our ideas, our opinions, our memories, our hopes, our fantasies, our daydreams. We live totally in our mind. But what is a thought? Have we ever seen a thought? What is a thought? We say, I think. Well, what is this thought? What is it? What does it look like? What does it feel like? And then, of course, the ultimate question, well, who thinks? We say, I think. Okay, who is I? Who is I? Everything we do is from this I. I think, I like, I don't like, I'm afraid, I'm a good person, I'm a bad person, I'm depressed, I had a terrible childhood, I had a wonderful childhood. Who is I? And the only way we can answer this question is really by experiencing the answer for ourselves. It's no good reading books. It's no good even going to the lamas. Only what even the most realized lama can only give you words. They can give you direction, but they cannot do it for you. The most they can say is, try like this and this. But we have to realize it for ourselves. And it's very important that we don't just become satisfied with the theories. So that we become very clever at being able to expound about self and non-self and all this sort of thing. But it doesn't help at all. Somebody slaps you in the face and slap back, you know. The theory of no self, the theory of emptiness, doesn't help at all unless it is not just a theory, but it is actually an experience. So therefore, it is very important to have space in our life to just sit and use the mind to look at the mind. Nothing else. Imagine you're in a cinema, right? And you're watching a movie. And so there it is, and it's on this big screen, so it's completely filling up your whole visual line of contact. And, you know, it's, I don't know what kind of movie it is. Sometimes it's a happy movie and we're all laughing, and then suddenly the hero gets hurt and we're all in tears, and then something happens and we're all tense. And we're completely involved in this movie. And if it has a happy ending, we come out smiling. And if it's a sad ending, and it's ruined our evening. And we're totally caught on the screen, right? Drawn, sucked into it. If it's a good movie, you're totally with it, right? But supposing, instead of looking at the screen, you turn around and look behind. Now behind, all you see is light coming down, right? This beam of light. Now that beam of light is as it happens, because all metaphors and similes have their shortcomings. So that's actually projected by a projector. Forget the projector. You think of the light, right? So you have this light, and this light goes through these transparent frames, right? Now, each one of these frames is whirling incredibly fast, and the light is going through it. And because it's going so fast, although it's, each one is a momentary frame, it looks as though there is movement. It looks as though there is action on the screen, right? And because of that, we believe in what is happening on the screen. And this is very, very close to what is actually happening within us. From the pure light nature of the mind, it radiates through all these little frames of the individual thoughts, which then project this outer world, this outer panorama which we perceive. And we believe in it. Once one is conscious of the source, then as if we were conscious of the light coming from the projector and going through the frame, we can know that. We can still enjoy the movie. But if the hero dies at the end, we don't go out and slit our throats, because we know it's just a movie, right? It's not a matter of life and death. It's just a movie, these are just actors. So if we understand that about our own mind, that we are constantly, moment to moment to moment, projecting this whole display, then we can enjoy it. We can cry at the sad parts and laugh at the good parts, but we don't, at a very essential level, take it too seriously. Do you understand? Our problem is that we believe it all. We think this is really true and exactly how it is. And it isn't. We are deluded. This is our fundamental ignorance speaking to us. And this is why we suffer. We suffer because we believe it. Okay? Now, as I mentioned last week, basically from an experiential point of view, not from a philosophical point of view, but from an experiential point of view, there are two aspects to the mind. There is the known. That is, there are the thoughts, memories, anticipations, daydreams, all the thinking, and there are the emotions. The happiness, the sadness, jealousy, greed, joy, love, hatred. These feelings which well up inside us. And those are called the known. And there is the knower. There is that aspect of the mind which knows. But which is not involved. Some people call it the observer or the witness. The awareness. Now, normally, when we think or when we feel, we are totally involved in what we think or what we feel. It's really like being in the midst of a turbulent ocean. We're tossed up and we're tossed down. Today, happy, tomorrow, miserable. We have no control. You see, one of the problems is that we are totally out of control. We are not master of our minds at all. We are the slaves to our minds. If we were masters of our minds, we could say, okay, from now on, I'm going to be happy, I'm going to be loving, I'm going to be peaceful. I'm never going to be miserable or mean or angry again. And so it would be. Who would choose to have a mind full of anger and despair and worries? We wouldn't choose. But because we are not in control, because we are the slaves to our thoughts and our emotions, we are full of miserable, sad memories and resentments and angers and fears. We are full of worries and depressions and anger. We don't choose those things. But it shows us that our mind is totally out of control. But the knower is not affected by this. The knower just knows. The knower seems as if it is behind all these thoughts and feelings and emotions. Just this quiet, totally conscious and aware, absolutely vivid and pristine and naked awareness. Which we all have. Everyone has. Without that, there would be no thoughts and feelings, because it is the root of the awareness, which then, from that light which is coming out, goes through the frames and then creates this whole panorama. Right? So we go back from the panorama to seeing the frames. And then through seeing the frames and understanding the frames, we can then go back to the source of the frames. Okay? Do you understand? Are you following? This is very simple, but it's quite difficult to do. Okay. So what do we do here? There are two things, it seems to me, that we can do immediately. One is that we can stop being in the thoughts and the feelings and step back. There's a very difference between thinking and knowing you are thinking. In an instant. And so to step back, this knowing is very bare, it's very naked, because it doesn't have any opinions. It doesn't like or dislike or judge. It just sees. The Buddha is sometimes described as the one who knows, the one who sees. Because he is in that state constantly. In Malaysia, there's this T-shirt which shows these big waves. And on top of the waves is a surfboard. And on top of the surfboard is a figure sitting in meditation. And the slogan says, "Riding the waves of life, be mindful, be happy." Right? So this awareness, in a way, is like a surfboard. You're not immersed in the waves anymore. You're riding the waves. And if you watch a good surfer, you see how extremely poised, extremely balanced they are. They're totally in the moment. They can't lose it for a minute or they fall under. Right? They have, actually, probably surfing could be a very deep spiritual practice, because you have to be present. All the Australians will say, yeah, yeah, yeah. So it's like that in the mind. In the mind, you're surfing. In that you're really riding the thoughts and the feelings. You're not immersed in them. You're on top of them or behind them. Right? So, whatever suffering we feel, whatever depressions or worries or anger or fear, behind it all is this totally different awareness which is absolutely spacious, vast, and totally peaceful. And that is our real nature. Our nature isn't the agitations and the worries and the fear. I mean, one very classic example is the sky, of course, which today is being very kind to us, because the nature of the mind is like the sky. Clear, blue, deep, vast, infinite. Immaculate. And of course, the sky isn't just up there, the sky is here. You know, it's space. Where does the sky finish? It never finishes. It's outside, inside, everywhere. It's all pervading. Like today's sky, vast. But normally it's monsoon, right? It's covered by thick, dark thunder clouds. And it goes on for month after month, and we think there never was a blue sky. That was just all fiction. Right? So in our minds, normally we're in the monsoon continually. Thick black clouds, a few little white fluffy clouds from time to time. But where's the sky? And so we don't even know there's a sky. We don't even know there's this deep blue infinite sky. We only see the clouds and we identify with the clouds. This is the problem. You see, the problem is not thoughts. The problem is not emotions. The problem is not feelings. That's the nature of the mind, to have thoughts and feelings and emotions. The problem is that we identify with that. We think, this is me. This is who I am. And therefore we suffer. If we didn't identify, there would be no problem. They're just passing thoughts, passing feelings, let them go. They're just mental states which arise in the mind, stay for a short time, and then subside. Like clouds in the sky. They're thick black clouds, thunder and lightning, can be quite exciting. And then they subside. Where did they go? So, therefore, it is very important to come into contact with this other level of awareness within us. Because once we see the sky, then we believe, yes, the sky really does exist. Until we have seen it, we can only believe in the clouds. And so, therefore, a lot of meditations, certainly in the Buddhist tradition, are intended to introduce us to the nature of the mind. And normally, one of the ways which this is done is just by teaching people first how to become very calm, very quiet, because while the surface of the mind is very agitated and chattering, it's very difficult to be able to really see what's going on there. It's too busy. And also because the surface mind is chattering away so much, it's very difficult to get to more subtle levels of the mind. So therefore it makes a lot of sense to spend time just getting the mind quietened down. To get the surface chatter to quieten down a bit and to bring into prominence a faculty of the mind which is called one-pointedness. That means the ability to actually be able to have single-minded concentration. So normally, certainly in the Tibetan school and in the Chinese schools, the Mahayana schools, a lot of attention is given at first to learning just how to make the mind quiet and more concentrated. Then when the mind has quietened down and is more concentrated, then one can use it as a very workable instrument to understanding what is the mind itself. You see, merely being peaceful, merely going into meditation and feeling blissful and happy and very calm, that's very nice, but it doesn't solve anything. It's very transitory, very fragile. I mean, there are stories in the old tales of India of great sages who meditated for centuries and centuries and went into deep samadhis. And then maybe somebody came along and interrupted them in their samadhi, and they're so angry that from the third eye, flames come out and destroy the person in front of them who disturbed them. You know, so much for overcoming anger. Or there are other stories in which some rishi, some great sage, has been meditating for centuries and has become extremely powerful that the gods feel threatened because it looks like he's going to become even more powerful than the gods. So then they send one of the daughters of the gods, these pink-footed nymphs, to distract the rishi. So when the rishi opens his eyes and sees this absolutely irresistible nymph in front of him, he just jumps, right? And very quickly dissipates all the power that he has been accumulating through centuries and centuries. And then the gods sigh and say, right, we can relax for the next few centuries till he builds up again. It's like a pressure cooker, right? You take the thing off and it will go psh. So the point of this is that merely going into very deep levels of concentration, very deep levels of inner absorbance and trance doesn't solve the fundamental problems. They are still there. They're just kept underneath. It's like there's this kind of cloud level that covers them over. So when you look into the mind, it looks like the mind is totally peaceful and quiet and pure. But actually, all the tendencies to anger and lust and ignorance have not actually been addressed. They're still there underneath. So what we need to do when the mind is quiet is then, and concentrated, is then to use that to look into the mind itself and to recognize the mind and the thoughts and the feelings as just thoughts and feelings. Because, as I said, normally we are a slave to our thoughts and feelings. If once we recognize them as being just what they are, mental events which arise, stay for a moment and go and are replaced, then they lose their hold. We can still enjoy the movie, but we don't really believe it anymore. And we can change the movie. If we don't like being miserable, we have a choice. There was this great yogi called Gyawago Tsangpa in the 13th century. And his mother had left him when he was very young, so he was brought up by his father. And he was very, very devoted to his father. And his father and he practiced together and traveled together, and they were very close. And then his father died. And he was completely distraught, I mean, really filled with grief. And he mourned very deeply. And then one morning he woke up and said, this is totally useless. What is this? It is not a nice state of mind to be miserable. From now on, I take a vow that I will never be sad again. Anybody willing to take that one up? And from that time on, he was never sad again. He refused. He said, this is not a helpful state of mind. I'm not going to allow it into my mind again. Every time I start to feel sad, I will transform it into something more positive. It's not that he suppressed it. It's not that he didn't acknowledge sad thoughts. But when sad thoughts came, he recognized them for what they were. And through that recognition, he was able to transform them. So everything which comes into our mind, if we recognize it in the moment that it arises, if we accept it, we can then just let it go. We don't have to hold on to it. We don't have to give it energy. We don't have to be swept away. We are on the riverbank, looking at the river flowing. We are not right in the middle of the river being swept along. We can all do this. The nature of the mind is naturally knowing. Without that, we would be dead. So all we have to do is go back to what we really are and stop identifying with the wrong thing. There was a very great Thai forest master called Ajahn Chah. And recently I was reading his biography. And in that, when he was in the forest training under several masters, at some point he came to exactly this. He realized that basically the mind, I wish I had it, I should have brought it with me. He puts it very succinctly. But that the mind basically is that which is known and that which knows. And the whole point is simply to dwell with that which knows. Start identifying with that which knows and stop identifying with the known. That's all. It's so easy. Really, I mean, 98% of your problems are solved, if not 100%. Just by doing that. But we don't do it. It's interesting that we don't do it. when one is in the presence of a very great Lama with whom there is a deep karmic connection, it can happen that if one's own mind is very open and receptive, completely without expectations, but very open, he can give what is called, in Tibetan it's called ngotro. It means like pointing out, introducing you. And he can introduce you to the nature of the mind. He doesn't give you anything. You already have it. And it's a very simple experience. It's nothing, it's not, you know, rainbow lights and trumpets. It's very simple, but in that moment, just for a moment, everything falls apart. And there is just that moment of total naked awareness. It's extremely simple. It's so simple that you can miss it very easily, because we always expect that somehow it's going to be some really great experience, something really... And normally it's so plain, so bare. That almost people might think that can't be it. One time, one of our yogis up the hill was giving an oral transmission of one very famous Dzogchen text. Dzogchen is the mind training of the Nyingmapa school. And he was, of course, reading it out. And then he stopped and he said, you know, the problem with these kind of books is that it makes it all sound very high and very far and very fantastic. And it's so simple. It's so right here. And so you're looking out there in the future for some incredible thing to happen. And all the time, actually, moment to moment, it's already happening. But we don't recognize it. You see, every time you hear a sound, everything you see, you can only see, you can only recognize a sound because of awareness. If we had no awareness, we would be like a corpse. But we don't recognize that awareness because we're so fascinated by our senses. Do you understand? Because we're so captivated by this panorama outside and all the panorama inside, all our thoughts and memories and daydreams and hopes and dreams, we miss the fact that behind all that is the knowing of it. Without that, we couldn't know, in fact. So every moment we are actually right there, but we don't know it. We don't know that we know. Therefore, in Dzogchen texts, it often says, there's no need to meditate. You've already got it. Who says you can't know it? You can't live without knowing it. There's nothing, you know, I mean, it's a paradox. Because in order to hear, to see, to think, we have to know. So who says we don't know? But the problem is we don't recognize. We don't recognize what we know. Every moment. There's nothing to get. We already have it all. We just have to uncover it. So therefore, it's good, as I said at the beginning, to sit and allow ourselves some space. Space just to be. Not to do anything in particular, just first of all, just to Just be present, just to know what is happening in this moment. Not try to manipulate it, not try to alter it in any way, just to know it. What does the body feel like? What are the sense organs picking up at this moment? Not judging it, not thinking, oh, there's that terrible, you know, truck going by again, or there's my neighbors quarreling again, or not judging good or bad, just knowing in this moment what is actually happening in our body. Feel the body. What does it feel like as you're sitting there? Not whether you're comfortable or uncomfortable, just how it feels, how it is. And then how is the mind in this moment? What is actually happening in the mind at this moment? How does one feel at this moment? Not good or bad, just what is it? And then, who knows this? If I hear the sound of the birds, how do I hear the sound of the birds? Who hears the sound of the birds? What is this knowing quality which knows that this is birds? So then, when the mind is quietened, we look at the mind itself. The example is that of someone, as I said, sitting on the banks of the river, watching the water go by. So we begin to look into the mind at the different, as the mind just goes by, not judging it, not thinking this is a good thought or a bad thought or a stupid thought or a brilliant thought, not giving energy to the thoughts, just knowing them, just observing them. And if we do that, then gradually, as the power of our awareness becomes stronger, so the mind itself begins to calm down. The thoughts, instead of, they say at the beginning, it's like a waterfall, you know, it's just this solid mass of thinking, just whoosh. And then it's a bubbling stream. And then it turns into a long, slow-moving river, and eventually it enters into the ocean. But while it's a slow-moving stream, when the awareness is very, very clear and poised, the thoughts have slowed down and are just meandering through the mind, and one is totally with them, just observing. It can happen that the links in the mind, the frame in the movie, separate. And in that moment, one sees that which lies behind the thoughts and the feelings. One sees that non-dual awareness. It's like suddenly you see the light behind all those frames, instead of frames. One, at that moment of seeing, then that which sees, that which knows, and this other pristine, bare, naked awareness are one, because they are one. And then the task. This is a very non-dual awareness. There is no I observe. There's no I am aware. There is just awareness. Normally when we say, I know, right? It's I know this, I know that. So there is immediately a duality, right? There is a known and there is someone who knows. But in this kind of knowing that we have been trying to, I've been trying to express to you, there is no I behind it. There is just the naked knowing. And because there is this bare awareness, there is no question of judgment. There is no question of conceptualizing. That belongs to the known. doesn't belong to the knower. So then when we are really observing the mind very, very moment to moment to moment, it can happen that the conceptual thinking falls apart. And at that time, the one who observes and the observed become non-dual awareness. Usually that just lasts for a moment. But after that, the task, in a way, you could say, is to prolong those gaps and make them more frequent. It's like flashes. When you meditate, it's like suddenly a flash of knowing. And then the mind comes back in, oh, wow, yes, now I've got it, you know, and it's gone, right? But to prolong that and to make them come more and more often. Also during the day, not just during meditation, but whenever we think of it, to bring ourselves into that state of awareness. We can do it. This is really the quickest way. I mean, you won't become great philosophy teachers, and you won't maybe even become great meditation teachers, but you certainly will be in a state of awareness, of total knowing. You will know, not know about, but know. You see, most of our knowledge is about and about and about. We don't directly experience. So then we quote this one who quoted that one who quoted this one who quoted that one. We think this is knowledge. But this is just lots of, you know, mind games. There is a world of difference between knowing and knowing about. Absolutely. I mean, please believe me, I think it's wonderful if you study. I think it's wonderful if you do all these tantric visualizations and so on and so on. I mean, I'm not in any way disparaging all that. The Tibetans through centuries and centuries, and not just the Tibetans, but in other Buddhist countries also, have produced extraordinary amounts of realized beings. Extraordinary. I mean, when one considers Tibet with such a tiny, tiny population, I mean, you know, a fifth of London, greater London, you know? I mean, it's such a tiny population and so many great realized beings. So I'm in no way disparaging their training and their studies and their meditational techniques, which were fantastic, amazing. But some of you don't have time for all that. You have families, you have careers, you have your social life. You're only going to be in India for a short time. You don't have time to go into 20-year retreats. So what can you do? What can you do, and what kind of technique can you have which you can carry into your everyday lives, which you can really use in every moment, under every circumstance? And this quality of being this pristine awareness behind the coming and going of the thoughts and the feelings, this is something which hits the essential point. These other practices, they polish the mind, but this is the real gold mind. You know, in Buddhism, they have this very beautiful custom in all Buddhist countries of when one does something which is basically a good thing to do, which is a virtuous thing to do, which is a nice thing to do, they rejoice. They don't just think of all the bad things they've done and hit themselves over the head as an evil sinner. They rejoice also in the good. the good that they themselves have done, the good that others have done. And then in situations like this, we gather up all that basic goodness of coming here. I mean, you could have done anything on this beautiful day in Dharamsala. And you chose to come here and sit on this hard, cold floor. And that's a good thing to do, you know? Really. So feel happy about that. And then that all these people came here to do this. And then gather that up. Imagine it all being gathered up and then offered throughout the universe to all beings everywhere, not just human beings, but animals and fish and birds and beings in the spirit realms, beings in the heavenly realms, beings in the ghost realms, beings in the hells, throughout the universe, everywhere, every single being, that they may also rejoice and that they may also benefit and that they also may be able to receive a spark to enlighten their spiritual path and to light up their darkness. So for 1 minute, we just sit and think like that.